And yeah, for the measurement of this is how we measure the passive digital frequency. And here we present illusory digital stimulus in the upper visual field, and physically or real digital stimulus in the lower digital field, in the lower visual field. So this is the illusion that brain creates, and that this is the this is the jitter that brain creates, and this is the jitter computer generates. And frequency of this, speed of this real jitter was manipulated from 4 to 13 Hz. And subject judged whether this real jitter frequency is faster than this usual jitter frequency. And as a result, we can get this kind of psychometric function. So this is the real jitter frequency, so the frequency of this real jitter. And this is the percentage of trials where subject answers that this real frequency is faster than this illusory jitter frequency. And we can define the passive jitter frequency as the frequency with the 50% response. So in this frequency, subject said this is fast in half of the trials and this is fast in the half of the trials, so that the passive jitter frequency a passive frequency is, can be regarded as equivalent between these two at this frequency. So this is how we measure the passive digital frequency. And this is an example of the frequency spectrum. So this is the brain neural data. And for this, and actually blue, red means eye closed condition, and blue means eye open condition. And you found a huge enhancement of alpha oscillation when you close eyes, as is reported by several research. And for this subject, the alpha frequency was found to be 10.3 Hz when they close eyes. And this is the behavior or perceptual data. And for this subject, the passive frequency was found to be 10.2 Hz, which seems to match very well with the frequency when they close eyes. And this was not only the case for this subject, and actually for the other subject, we found a very nice match between passive jitter frequency and intrinsic alpha frequency measured during the resting state. So that this suggests that passive jitter frequency seems to mirror individual peak alpha frequency. So in other words, with this illusion, you are watching your own alpha oscillation. And this figure shows the relationship between peak alpha frequency measured during the resting state, and this shows the passive jitter frequency measured psychophysically. And we found a very strong correlation. And correlation was very high. And so that the illusory jitter is passive at the frequency of intrinsic alpha frequency that subjects have already have. And if you look at the relationship between peak alpha power and jitter frequency, then there was no correlation. So that this passive jitter frequency seemed to reflect the intrinsic peak alpha frequency. And this is related to your question, but here I'm showing the alpha frequency during rest, and this shows the actually alpha frequency during the observation of illusory jitter. And as I mentioned, there was a very strong correlation between them. And actually, there was a small increase in frequency when you observe jitter compared to resting state. But the inter-individual difference was bigger compared to the within subject variability. So this means that peak alpha frequency during the perception of illusory jitter was highly correlated with the frequency during the resting state. So then how do we interpret this result? So this is our hypothesis. And so as you probably know, there is both a ventral pathway and a dorsal pathway processing different visual attributes. And our idea is that there are two position representations, one in dorsal and the other in ventral. And these two representations are working somehow complementary. And we propose that in the dorsal pathway, the position position of the object is represented based on motion. And this pathway might have high temporal resolution but has low spatial resolution. So on the other hand, in the ventral pathway, position might be represented based on object detection, so that it might have a low temporal resolution but has high spatial resolution. So that these two position shown representations are sort of working complementary to each other. So that's the basic idea. And in the case of this motion-induced spatial conflict, so this illusory jitter perception, actually, so in this dorsal pathway, you can calculate the position of object by integrating the speed. So if you integrate the speed, you can calculate the position. But if you calculate the position based on motion, then the speed of this red and green border is slower than the speed of this red and black border. So that the position of green bar is delayed relative to the surrounding red square. But on the other hand, in the ventral pathway, this is processed as a whole object, as a snapshot at each point. So this is this pathway doesn't take into account the motion information. So in this case, the position of this green bar is represented correctly at the middle of the red square. So in this illusion case, so actually this is a very tricky case. But here, there is dissociation between position representation in dorsal pathway and ventral pathway. And the idea here is that actually that this dissociation between dorsal and ventral pathways were upgraded at the rhythm of alpha oscillation. So that's why you perceive the illusory jitter at 10 Hz. And so to put it more generally, we propose that alpha oscillation might function as a clock signal for the interaction between visual areas, which is the interaction between dorsal pathway and ventral pathway. And at least for now, I'm just studying this illusion. But in the future, we want to prove that this hypothesis is a more general hypothesis. And even with the natural oscillation, we believe that the alpha oscillation might function as a clock signal to decide the timing of the interaction between visual areas. Sure.
Sorry, I think you already explained this, but why does the dorsal pathway find a delay in the
Yeah, so here I assume that the position of object is calculated based on motion speed. So if you integrate the speed across time, then you can calculate the position, right? And but the problem here is that red and greens are said to be isoluminant. And several psychophysical researchers have shown that the isoluminant border without changing luminance is perceived to be much slower than the luminance-defined border, which is red and black border in this case. So that there's a difference in perceived speed between this red, this green bar and surrounding red square. So that if you integrate the speed, then the position of the green bar tends to be delayed.
Is that, so I understand that based on that two visual systems hypothesis, that mm-hmm. the dorsal pathway is usually for non-conscious perception, and ventral is for conscious perception, but maybe that's wrong.
It's true that, for example, the blind sight is sort of associated with the dorsal pathway. But here, I assume that both pathways are sort of conscious. And this pathway also might also have unconscious, might be also involved in unconscious processing. But here, I'm sort of implying both conscious processing.
And there's some empirical evidence for that, too.
Think so, yeah. For example, the dorsal pathway is processing motion nowadays, but we can definitely perceive motion nowadays, for example.
Okay, so I have a question about our observation. So you said that we are resting state of our calm state, so we can observe the alpha. We can observe the alpha oscillation in the resting state mm-hmm. or the calm state. So if you see something like gating the jitter cases or
actually, yeah, that's a good point. So basically, I compare the peak alpha frequency measured during resting state and the passive digital frequency, and I found correlation. But alpha oscillation not only appears not only in the resting state, but also even during the illusory digital observation.
So alpha oscillation can be observed anywhere.
I think alpha oscillation works every time.
Oh.
But the power is more evident when you close eye or when you react. But yeah, at least my hypothesis is that actually alpha oscillation is always working as a clock signal for the interaction between visual areas. So I haven't proved it.
From this viewpoint, why the resting state of alpha oscillation is gradual?
That's a point. Yeah, actually, the generation mechanisms of alpha oscillation not quite established, and I'm not sure, but it generally says that it's generated based on the interaction between thalamus and visual areas. And I'm not sure how the power is modulated within that group, cortical, thalamocortical loops. But here, basically, the idea is that alpha oscillation already exists, and the visual system makes use of that oscillation to determine the timing of the interaction. That's the hypothesis. Okay, so then, so this is the first part, and I move on to the, sorry, to the second part. So which I believe can look at the neural cause of perception. So as I mentioned earlier, we typically, to look at the neural correlates of perception, we typically contrast the neural activity corresponding to some percept and other percept. But actually, there's a problem with this approach. Actually, Nao has already mentioned, but I will explain again. So, so for example, if you see this stimulus, one type of brain activity will result in this visible yellow dot perception. And the other types of activity will result in invisible dots. But at the same time, we are interested in this difference in activity, which I call neural cause of perception, which is the neural activity causing this perception. But at the same time, there are several epiphenomena associated with this difference in perception. For example, if you see yellow dots, you might imagine a star or a moon or, I don't know, banana or something. And also, the epiphenomena might also involve this activity related to report. Reporting whether you see dots or not. And if you look at the neural correlates, it is very difficult, generally very difficult to dissociate neural cause of perception from epiphenomena that is not directly related to the perception itself.
I like this framework, and I'm definitely thinking that the report is one type of a phenomena, but the association with other concepts, that's
like associated like, with memory.
Yeah, after seeing yellow, automatically thinking about the banana or you know moon.
Uh-huh.
Do you think that's an a phenomena?
I think so. At least we can perceive yellow dots without imagining.
Yeah, but philosopher called something as a phenomenon as something that doesn't have any causal, you know, relationship with, you know, other things. But you know, after seeing the yellow, thinking about the moon or thinking about the banana seems to have some kind of function.
Uh-huh.
Right? It prepares for, you know, another movement or whatever future plan or whatever. So I feel like association to other ideas are difficult to call as an epiphenomena. It may be an essential feature of seeing yellow.
But at least my logic is that I will introduce a technique to manipulate brain activity with neurofeedback.
Right.
And if we can create a color perception, for example, then I think we can conclude that the manipulation is associated with the perception itself rather than perceiving banana, imagining banana or star or something. Right. That's the basic idea.
It's just sort of technology kind of thing. Maybe philosophers find that that calling that, you know, association as a phenomenon have a problem. I don't know.
Indeed, I was a bit confused, but now I make it clear.
Okay, good. And to solve this problem, so actually, at least I'm more interested in neural causal perception rather than the epiphenomena. And one promising technique to look at the causation is the decoding neurofeedback, which was originally developed by Shibata et al. So in this analysis, we typically use fMRI, but you can also use other measuring modalities. So here we first define a target brain area and measure the brain activity, and then calculate the correlation between this current activity pattern with the target pattern. So this target pattern was decided by experimenter, so that this is the target of brain activity. And this correlation is shown to the subject. So, and the subject tried to change their own brain activity based only on this disk size. And actually, the advantage of this technique is that a specific brain activity pattern in a specific brain region can be induced with decoded neurofeedback. So, for example, if you put TMS on a visual area, then you can create some very coarse brain activity in the occipital area. But here, the variety of information, brain activity we can create, the variety is much larger, so that it's much more advantageous compared to the TMS or such other techniques.
Amano-san, yeah. Can we do that for arbitrary pattern, mm-hmm. or it is easier for the particular pattern associated with certain cognitive process?
So what do you mean?
So in decoding neurofeedback, so you first design the decoder and then the subject activate or deactivate the brain accordingly. Mm-hmm. But you can design a kind of random target pattern. So can subject fit the brain activity to an arbitrary state, or it is necessary for that pattern to be associated with certain percept or imagination?
Yeah, that's a very important point, but we haven't tested. So this experiment is very costly, so we haven't tried a random pattern for the target.
So we cannot try this tomorrow.
Yeah, that's a very interesting point, but we haven't tested that. But my guess is that the subject cannot change the brain activity if we just randomly create this pattern, because the variety of, so if you just assume binary activity of each voxel, then the combination is sort of infinite. But the fact that subjects can still change the brain activity suggests that sort of the search direction or the dimensions brain activity can change is sort of limited, so that if you just create target pattern by random, then it will be difficult for subject to change their brain activity towards that pattern, but we haven't tested that, so I'm not sure. Okay, so in the conventional correlation analysis, we try to manipulate perception, behavior, cognition, and try to look at the neural activity correlated with these variables. So in the first experiment, I manipulated the individual digital perception and try to find out and found that the alpha oscillation is a neural correlate of this individual digital perception. But in the case of decoded neurofeedback, we manipulate brain activity and then look at the change in perception, behavior, cognition, so that we can say more about the causation. And actually, in the first experiment, we tried to create color perception associated with an orientation by manipulating neural activity in the primary and secondary visual areas. So these are lower visual areas. And actually, during the observation of achromatic particle wiring, subjects try to associate the brain activity pattern corresponding to red color. And we asked whether this achromatic grading is perceived to be reddish or not.